Don Yitzchak Abravanel was born in basically 1437, and lived until 1508. It's not such a long life. It was a very full life and very exciting life. But he was one of the people and one of the greatest, because in one way, he was not just. He was a minister in different governments. He, in many ways, at certain times, he was very important in forming the policies of one country after another. He was a big financier, and he possibly was at the peak of his career, an enormously rich person. He had to live most of it in Spain, as he had to live, as he says, very, 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 very unhappily. Had to live to bury all the books he had that he couldn't carry with him, so they were buried somewhere in Spain. But still, that was one way, the great financier, the person that was the advisor of kings, and possibly the person that led things in many what are called historical and political events. On the other hand, and together, because even though there were times when he was far more busy in state affairs or in Jewish affairs, in other times, and he, it was, to speak about the person, he was always, in a way, feeling that he's possibly wasting his time doing politics or doing finances when he could be, and he was, a great Jewish scholar. So he was, from time to time, I'm not just saying it because I say of belated psychologism, because he writes about it. He writes about it, how many times he was thinking that even his sufferings are a punishment for being too much involved in this world instead of the higher world. But anyway, he still managed to write a fair number of books, of different important books in themselves, even though the impact on and in general was not equal to the great number of books that he wrote. But at least even when people didn't know anything about his historical position, they knew his name as a rabbi, as an author, and vice versa. So that is the person, had two sides to his nature. Now, most of the people that I'm going to speak about had those different sides to them, but not so in such a remarkable way, in such a way of, some of them were more leaning to one side, others to the other side, but he was, in a certain way, he's equally in both worlds. Now, we know that he came from a family that was already an influential, very influential, very rich family. This family of Abravanel was known a few generations before as great men, as people that were involved, he was not a shamish or a gabbain shul. They were people that were dealing with kings and leading living, what happens, what happened in the history, and this was for several generations of the family. Incidentally, and that is, they had always the notion, not, I don't think it was proven, but they were always claiming that they are descendants of the King David, which could be very well true, but I'm just saying that that was a part that you may meet Abravanels even today. There are some here and there that you can find. Again, some of them are important people. Some of them are just people with carrying the name, and all of them are very proud of this of the royal descent. All of them are proud of it. That is some of them don't remember almost anything else from being Jewish except that they are descendants of the King David. Anyway, it was a powerful family and a family that was again very much into Jewish life. Because even in those times, there were people that were more or less, in one way or another, far more involved in the general world than in the Jewish world. But this was a family that was a scholarly family, and Don Yitzchak Abravanel got a good education, a good Jewish education from the very beginning. So he... I suppose that, except his what I call his Hebrew, which is very fluent in his writings, except for his Hebrew, he surely knew and used extensively Latin, not to speak about Spanish and Portuguese, if they're as little distinguished as they were at those times, and possibly Italian as well. So he was saying in both ways important, and he had basically from the very beginning he wanted to create things also in the Jewish world. Some of his books were, he began at a quite early age, in his 20s perhaps. Many of them he didn't finish until his 60s, but they were books that he began and works that he dreamt about. Possibly not all of them were finished, but he did a great amount of work. It was, again, getting in and out in those two worlds. Now, after his father, who was again practically the finest minister in his country, Don Yitzchak Abravanel, I don't know if he inherited the position, but he inherited more or less the basic stance of being not just the most important Jew in the country, but also the person who was involved with the finances of the kings, and far beyond that, because even today, it's not such a big change in the world. Even today, the people who control the finances of a country have something of a say about the general politics of the country. Even today, surely in those times where they didn't have this departmentalized world was not as well developed then as now, when the same people were dealing with different things. But it was possibly, he was perhaps considered some kind of a financial wizard of the time, and he gave for the government. He got, for example, we know about huge loans that he gave to the king. And I'm saying huge, even in our time scales, huge loans, in which a great part of it were his own money. And usually it was money invested. And so he really became very rich and much more and more and more affluent. He was involved in all kinds of the politics with King Alphonse in the Aragon. His relationship was basically with Aragon, but he had to play with Castilia and with Aragon. He was accused of joining a revolt in Aragon, which was again these are interesting times from a political point of view. But there were times in which things happened. They were happening. That's also these are the times in which we can say the sinking or the end of the feudal system and the creation of the modern national states in one way or another. And with that, surely in Spain and in Portugal, they also began something that came from there. They were for many years the Christians, Spaniards, from the north, in which they were always there, places that were always Christian, like Navarra and so on, to other places which they conquered with the time. They were conquistados, conquerors, and that was a part of their tradition. And the next conquest, and that is a part in which also Jews were in so many times and so many reasons were involved in the conquest of the seas and the conquest of other countries. See, there was a time when these two countries took over a fair amount of the world. See, they not only discovered America and everything that was in it, but also many places in Africa and India, were their colonies. So it was this kind of a feeling of a desire for expansion, for growing into outside what seemingly a part of it. As I'm putting it, that's it, so to say, in brackets, so to say. There should be an interesting question about how much the Jews there and the Jewish influence there had any impact on these places, because Spain was in the 16th century and 17th century one of the biggest empires of the world. 200 years later, both Spain and Portugal are just backward countries that just need now a little bit of loans from others that they possibly despised at the time to get somehow an even keel in one way or another. Now, was it connected? I'm not speaking now about what I call historiosophical or theological arguments. In so many countries, there is a nice parallel that I'm not going to deal with it extensively, but just mentioning, there's a nice parallel between the relationship or the closeness of the local rulers with the local Jews. When there was a good connection and a good relationship, it was usually this parallel to the growth of those countries. When this sank somehow, well, it is a kind of a two parallel in the a two parallel events or basically one thing. You can see the same thing happening in many other countries. They kicked out or they suppressed the Jews, and somehow they sank. It's the same thing, say, for places. If you want two examples, say, take Poland. That was for a certain time, again, a big empire. And it became, nice poor Polacks. And take Turkey. It was once again a big empire in its own right. And there is a parallel. Now, whether there was such a parallel within Spain, it is something that cannot be proven, and that's something else. But anyway, Spain was, was going out and feeling very, very shrewd. Now, possibly Don Yitzchak Abravanel was involved in a certain way of making this shidduch between Castilia and Aragon, the two bigger countries within Spain that were fighting the Muslims and fighting each other, rivaling each other, and because they had the chance of that one of them had a son that was the heir, the other had a girl that was the heiress, so they had Ferdinand and Isabella, the king and queen of these countries, were married. That was the beginning of a certain unification of Spain, of the growth of Spain in many ways. There is some evidence that Don Yitzchak Abravanel wasn't dealing with politics, and marriages were always, even our times, in small scale politics. But in those times, when you speak about countries, it was surely big politics. So to unite those two kingdoms and to make them into something of a unity, I heard yesterday about they have some kind of a site in which they have the sculptures of Ferdinand and Isabella, and saying Ferdinand is like Isabella, Isabella is like Ferdinand, because both of them were kings. She was the consort of a king. She was a queen on her own right, and in her own country, and so they were, the notion that both of them are equal, and both of them were possibly very Catholic, and perhaps at the time, narrow-minded, and one of the very first, when they came, the power came more or less as unified in about 1480. But then, when they conquered together the last Muslim stronghold in Spain, they felt then that it's the time to clear the country of all foreign influences and to create a clean Catholic land. Incidentally, the Spaniards were the first, not the first, but they were the most dominant rulers for the existence of the Inquisition, which, again, because there are so many poor Jewish boys in Israel who don't know anything, and sometimes they think that the Inquisition had basically very little, officially it was nothing to do with Jews. The Inquisition was made mostly against the Maranos, against those that were converted to Christianity, and that the Inquisition was to clean up this part. They didn't even have any right over Jews as long as they were Jews. But that is something else. I'm saying there was a spirit there, a spirit of fanaticism, a spirit of, and that was the expulsion from Spain. Now, Don Yitzchak Abravanel, and we know that, and even to the last, he and the other big Jewish magnates of the realm of Spain, of what was then already Spain, it's a country, they tried to offer the kings of Spain any amount of money and to avoid this edict of expulsion. But basically it didn't work. So now Don Yitzchak Abravanel, who moved from one country to another, and I say he was in many ways he wasn't a military man, but he was surely very much of a political person, and it was to deal with the finance of the country, of a big united country, to unite all the all the the mechanisms and all the systems of those countries. That was his big work. But it went up to a certain level, which was he was allowed to leave the country. Generally speaking, in some kind of honor, but he was out. He was out. He was also, just to finish, so to say, his life history. He went to Italy, and he went, in fact, to Napoli, which was there was some kind of, again. It was a more or less under Spanish influence. There were again princes there, and again, when he came there, almost immediately. They appointed him as the chief minister of finance in India, and he stayed there until their country was conquered by the French and so on, destroyed. So he moved with them, and later on moved into other places. The family Abravanel, incidentally, was not only he was the most important person in the family in his lifetime, and perhaps viewed in a general way, but his children were also involved in political, financial, and scientific. At least there were many of them were famous doctors, some of them were financiers, and they brought him at the end to Venice. So, and then he died, which long. And again, we know that even in those times, even though he didn't have any official position, he was again asked to somehow create some kind of political negotiations between Venice, it was then a big power, Venice and Portugal. So he was used almost to his last day. As a, what I call, the big man of politics. Even in places in which the Jews were not given too much right, but again, he was outstanding, and everybody knew about his stature. But in those times, especially in the times of suffering, times of exile, it was, I thought he wasn't exiled in poverty, basically, and in most of the time, until there were all kinds of very unpleasant occasions, which he was when other armies came into the same country. But basically, he wasn't an impoverished person, and he had the time and the ability to write. Quite a number of books, and I'm now going just to speak about something about the books. Now, he wrote several kinds of books. He wrote commentaries about most of the Bible. If one should say something, it's perhaps, posthumously so very nice. He was a rich man. I'm not saying it as just to make a point about it. And he used to spend money, and he also wrote like this. If he could make his writings, say it about two-thirds of it, it would be far more influential, because it is sometimes to read him. He's not writing, he's very clear and very able to express himself. But okay, how long can you carry one idea for one page, two pages, three pages, and so on? Some people get tired from it, even people that are accustomed to study. But that is what he is doing now. His commentaries to the Bible, for example, have a basic system. He begins a chapter or a section there, and begins usually with a number of questions about the story, and these questions are different levels of questions, but most of them go to the contents. In that sense, he was not very much interested in grammar, even in philology per se. He was interested in ideas and in events. When he wrote about the books of the first books of the prophets, which means the books of the historical books of the Bible, he said again in his preface that he thinks that he's especially equipped to write about them, because unlike most of the other commentators, he knew what politics is, because these books that speak about what I call the history of the people of Israel in the first temple time, they are books that have to deal with the involvement and development of historical events, of political events, of interaction between the different powers. And he thought, anyway, it's rightly, that he understands these matters better than most other commentators, because he knew what he was writing about. So these books are going like this, and I'm saying he takes his time. If I may add something else, some of his questions are far more successful than his answers. See, no, I'm saying incidentally, it's not nothing like of a fault. Some people have the sense and the ability to see problems and to ask the right questions. Now, to ask the right questions is, as they used to say, a nice statement in Hebrew, that she'elat chacham chatzi tshuva. The question of a wise man is half of an answer, and it would be true about science in almost in every field. To formulate the right question is as important as finding an answer. When you get the right formulation for a question, you have already the basis for an answer for this question. So in that sense, he asked many questions. Some of them very basic questions, and he's also dealing in many ways with some of those things that many of the earlier commentators, and greater in creativity, greater in ability, like Rashi and others, didn't dare to ask these questions. About the questions about sequence of events, questions about morality, questions about how people do behave and how they should be judged, and so on. So his questions are many times good questions, and he does in many other books of his, in which he asks very good questions and he gives answers. And I say, now, his writing is, to give it some kind of a figure, even though he was, in many ways, a scholar in the Jewish sense, a scholar which means that knew the Jewish sources. And I'm not speaking now as a professor at the university now, which is, okay, can be examined on half of a book and give the answers that he was taught. But I'm speaking about, he was a scholar. He knew his Talmud, he knew the other books that people have to know. He knew them, but his basic writing is not so much Talmudic. It is also, interestingly, not very much, even though there was already the beginning, but it was almost, there's very little about Kabbalah in his writings. And a great amount of philosophy, in which he was involved, and he understood philosophy. He wrote, among other things, a commentary on the Rambam, on Moreh Nevuchim, in which he makes. And now he was a strong man. He wasn't afraid, practically, of anybody. Not his contemporaries, perhaps not in the past. He once writes about in some point, he says, now I explained up to now what Rabbeinu Moshe has to say, meaning the Rambam. It doesn't mean that that is the same thing that Moshe Rabbeinu thought to be right. So it's kind of, so in many ways, he writes a commentary on the Rambam, and some people said it's possibly one of the deepest and best commentaries on the Rambam, but he does write about it as a person that has to always to defend and to speak for the author. But he's in many ways, in his commentary, in several other books, is quite critical of the Rambam. He doesn't accept his opinion in a fair number of important points, as he didn't accept the opinions of many other people in the same time. But he is, in that sense, he had his own stance, his own way of dealing with things. He wrote books of commentary on the Rambam and on most of the Bible, on the Haggadah of Pesach, on Pirkei Avot, big volumes all, on Pirkei Avot. And each of them is interesting. All of them are full with his very, very good knowledge of other sources, because it's clear that he used Latin fluently. So he and there is sometimes in open way, sometimes hidden way, there is his what I call his relationship, his intellectual relationship also with the late fathers of the church, in writing, in comparing notes. He was philosophically speaking. He was not, he was not like the Maimonides. He wasn't a full Aristotelian. He was, in a certain way, he tried to make what some other people before him tried to do, and it's even true about Maimonides. There is some kind of a meetings and relations within Platonic and Aristotelian thinking in his writings. Just to make some remark, there was the son of Don Yitzhak Abravanel, who lived in Italy, wrote a book which is basically Neoplatonic philosophy, which is called Dialoghi d'Amore, Dialogues about Love. And this book was, in his time, it was possibly one of the best sellers of the time. They said that within the 25 years since the book appeared, it was published. Remember, we are speaking about the beginning of the 16th century. It was published dozens of times, and it was translated already in four languages except Italian. And still, at this time, it had a big influence. But that is basically, unlike his father, very much Neoplatonic philosophy, very much so. So, but the father was, he tried in a certain way to combine the ideas of Aristotelian philosophy, which he didn't accept completely. See, in that sense, he was an independent thinker. He didn't accept it completely. On the other hand, he has Platonian and Neoplatonian ideas mixed up, and some other influences in his writing. So they appear in almost all his books, which are, all in all, he is possibly full of philosophical knowledge. In many ways, he doesn't feel that he is dependent on that philosophical knowledge. He was in many ways far more important for him his what I call his Jewish ideas. And in this he sometimes tried to do all kinds of new things. There were at least three books that he wrote about what he thought was, as many people thought at the time, that it was a time, an apocalyptic time, in which it seems like the times that Mashiach is coming. The expulsion from Spain was for him one of the signs, but all the movement of the world, and people don't always remember it, but it's about the same time, it was the final, not a decline, but the final fall of the Roman Empire, of Byzantine. So it became what we call a Turkish possession. And so there was the biggest expansion and growth of the Muslims, and he was thinking about that there is the time coming for perhaps the big war in the world of the two contending powers, that at the end of them will be like in some of the prophetic books will come the times of the Mashiach. And his view of the Mashiach is, interestingly, I'm not going into details because some of it was quoted, and Abravanel is usually quoted when you want to find something, bizarre ideas, so you can find them there. So, because his opinions about the Mashiach are basically not like that of the Rambam. The Rambam pictures the Mashiach as a great ruler that will come, and it doesn't demand from him almost anything supernatural. Now, in the views of Abravanel, Mashiach is partially a supernatural being, and he speaks about it this way. Now, in so many ways, the books were at least timely books, because at the time it was, when you think about it, historically speaking, kind of a big depression for the Jews. His writings about the coming of Mashiach, and all the details that he writes, and his extensive use of the Jewish sources and different ways whether it is halacha, mostly agada, about it, about three books that I write, he's writing about that, which is very important in the time, and as I say, they are still quoted in nowadays in different ways. So his bulk of writings was basically centered around basic Jewish sources as a commentator and as a thinker. He was trying to promote some ideas, and if one speaks thinks about that, see, he surely understood politics. He understood what, as I say, even I don't know how many people of the time, generally speaking, understood it as well as he did. See, he was living in different countries, in different realms, and he was involved not just in small-time things, but in creating what I call the big issues. So he understood it. So when he writes about these issues, it's clearly outstanding in many ways. So, as I say, this is the man who was a man that was was outstanding person in every point, every side he wanted. He dealt with his, what he tried to do in Spain was, Jewishly speaking, wasn't very helpful for us. Possibly for the Spanish history, possibly the Spaniards should honor him much more than they did in that time, because of his involvement and his and what he gave to this country, building of the country, and so in so many many other places. In the Jewish area, he opened up different points of view, different points of view. And he also, see, he began, see, not only his questions, his open questions, but also his hidden questions, were not all of them developed at the time, but many of them came to bear fruit 100, 200, 300 years after him. So when the same kind of questions are arising again, and sometimes when you want to find something, somebody that deals with basic questions, both about faith, which has, he has, say, in one way, he's, okay, very novel and very, very unusual, and as I say, he didn't care much, or at least he wasn't dependent basically to anybody. So it is important, it is new, it is mostly beginning of things. He didn't create something that you may call in most places a permanent big structure. Not about even though he dealt with all kinds of things from the basic points of the credo to what people have to do. But basically, he didn't write much or very little about halacha. But he wrote about something about contemporary life and understanding ancient times. So in that sense, he's a different picture that is, in some ways, not in, it will be difficult to say, because to define it as such. He was, in one way, a form, a model of something that grew up in Spain. This kind of in Jewish Spain, not as epigons or as people are second rate people, but a person that is in a certain way is embodies within himself most of what one may call it the thinking of both of the Jewish world and the non-Jewish world, embodying in then putting them together, trying to create new things out of them, and in a way creating things that only many, many years ago there were anybody that tried to deal with such the big issues. And say he's not afraid of dealing with any big issue and fighting with anybody in the past, and sometimes a very clear, clear language, not offensive, but very clear. I don't want to quote some of the things that he said about Ashkenazi Jews. He didn't admire them over much, but he is again following a nice old Sephardi tradition. They didn't admire the Ashkenazi Jews, but anyway, he created a world. Into the world that is worthwhile in itself, and that is one of those outstanding personalities. They are not as some people are at the crossroads of historical development. In that sense, he was one of the people that were in the time. The world, even the Jewish world, developed not in the way that he thought about it. In fact, the same time, the same kind of, the same cut of the expulsion from Spain is also the beginning of what I would call it, the modern Jewish theology, which is mostly Kabbalistic. And he was not a part of it. He wasn't a part of it, but it was, he opened the way for that. He opened the way for that by disregarding the old material and creating a new building.